laisser mon cœur est tout petit. Je t'aime, te amo, je te hais, te odeio. Alors, então o que que a gente se diz?
Yeah, I can hear him. Hey, Paul, did you put him in the talk? Did you put him in the talk back just now?
Rendez-vous à la brasserie du café de la paix. Je t'attendrai. Je porte un feu. Couleur neutre et mon par-dessus n'est pas brillant non plus. Je poserai mon journal sur le bord devant moi. Je poserai mon journal. Tu me reconnaîtras si t'es en retard. Passer le cas. Je prendrai un demi.
We need to grab a tape roll and we'll just need to cock them back a little bit.
Je prendrai un sérieux. Pour le noyer mieux, je plierai mon journal sur le bar devant moi. Je plierai mon journal, tu me reconnaîtras. La 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 la. Tu voudras, tu me prendras le bras comme autrefois. On ira voir notre rue, notre chambre sixième. Tout ça n'existe plus, mais on ira quand même. L'annonce dans le journal est parée à moi. Si tu lis ce journal, tu te reconnaîtras. La 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 la. Maison de carton au bon mari. On ira voir ailleurs. On ira faire fortune. La 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 la. On ira voir ailleurs. Parce qu'il est l'heure. Les chaises sont sur les tables. C'est la fin de la fable. Je pose ce qu'il me reste sur le bar devant moi. Trois clous et un bouton de veste. Tu ne me reconnaîtrais pas. La nuit étreint le ciel.
Hey, Paul, can you lower the music, please? Yeah, that's going to be perfect right there. Yeah, that level will be good, Paul. Yeah, I can hear it, and I know once the music's gone, they're going to be able to hear it even more. Thank you.
Test. Hello. Hello. Test. Hello. Hello. Test. Hello. Test. Hello.
Kevin Harvick seat. Hey. Kevin Harvick seat. Check 1, 2. Hello. 1, 2. Kevin Harvick microphone. 1, 2, 3. I'm in the Josh Berry seat. 1, 2. Hey.
Tony Stewart, hey, what's up? Tony Stewart, go Panthers, Bryce Young. Greg Zipadelli, the seat. Hello, testing 1, 2, 3, testing 1, 2, 3.
To you.
Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Tony Stewart seat.
Once you hit. Thank you. So you're talking about the lights are a little hot? Are you saying the lights are a little hot? Or are you saying you're hot? I'm just gonna give you some tests.
This is seat number one. I'm gonna try to make these all the same. Like about right here, check 1, 2. Hey, you like this seat right here, Paul?
Check 1, 2, check 1, 2, seat 2, Tony Stewart.
1, 2.
Check 1, 2, seat 3, Josh Berry, check 1, 2. Seat number 4, Kevin Harvick, check 1, 2. Check 1, 2. Seat number 5, Rodney Childrens, check 1, 2.
Q&A microphone number 1, check 1, 2. Hey, what's that, Paul? What are you gonna do? This is Q&A microphone number 2, check 1, 2. 1, 2, 3, 4. Check 1, 2, 3, 4. Q&A mic number 2. Hey, check 1, 2.
Q&A mic number 3. Number 3. Number 4. Number four. Hey.
Uh-huh. 1, 2. Hey. 1, 2. Hey.
Q&A number 4. Yep. We'll be right back.
sound check. How's it sound back there? One, two, three. Check, check. One, two, three. Everybody good? Thumbs up, thumbs down. We got a thumbs up. Great. All right, well, thank you very much for coming out today. I'm Mike Arning with Stewart-Haas Racing. On behalf of the entire race team, we want to say thank you. And certainly want to say thanks to our host, Charlotte Motor Speedway, for giving us this spot to have our announcement today. And also want to say thanks for those listening on SiriusXM NASCAR Radio and tuning in to our live stream. Obviously, we've got some news to share with you today, and I think the optics make it pretty obvious as to what it's all about. So, Tony Stewart, the co-owner of Stewart-Haas Racing, you know, it's always a good day to break news like this, but it's not just good news, it's great news, because this is not just insight into what's going on with the four time, this is insight into SHR's future. So, Tony, talk a little bit about why we're here today.
Yeah, obviously, we're super excited to get to this moment today. It's there's been a lot of talk and a lot of speculation and a lot of questions of what are we going to do now that Kevin's retiring. So, you know, that leads us to today, and you know, I'll be perfectly honest. This was not a big group of people that we had to make a choice from. We literally put all of our eggs in one basket, and we put them on this kid to my left here with Josh Berry. He's somebody that we all feel like is the right fit to step into the four car in the future, and we're all super excited to have him at Stewart-Haas Racing. We just left the shop a minute ago. Everybody at the shop's extremely excited. We're excited. You know, to fill Kevin's shoes is a hard task, and we all are very confident off of Josh's merit and his maturity. Everything that he's done and all the positions he's put himself in shows that he's a smart race car driver, and that's exactly what we're looking for this four car.
Josh Berry, congratulations. You're the man of the hour, but also the man of the future here at Stewart-Haas Racing. Describe this moment and the opportunity ahead of you.
Yeah, no, thank you. You know, obviously, this is a really special day for me and special for a lot of people. You know, first off, I have to thank, you know, everybody sitting up here with me for believing in me and, you know, bringing me here to do this. This is such a special day. And it's been a lot of fun process over the last couple months, getting to know these guys and working with them, and you know, it's I can't imagine a better opportunity for myself than to be full time cup racing with Stewart-Haas and headed for the four car. So you know, our expectations are going to be simple, and that's just to keep working hard and keep doing the things that this group has been doing for years, and working hard and believing each other, and we think that if we do the right things and stay the course, that the results will come. And just really special day for a lot of people in my life, and excited to be here. And you know, in the meantime, these guys got a lot of racing left to do this year as well, and I'm going to be excited to cheer on Kevin and Rodney and his whole group, as well as everybody at Stewart-Haas. And you know, obviously on my side of things, I have a lot of racing to do myself with Junior Motorsports, so we're ready to get going.
And Kevin Harvick, you're the current driver of the number four Ford Mustang, have been for a decade now. You've accomplished a lot, championship in 2014, 37 points paying victories. What are your thoughts on Josh taking over the number four car in 2024?
Well, I'm excited for everybody at this table. Honestly, you know, I think as I look for, you know, people who can get in the car and fit with the group of people that I've been fortunate to race with for the last 10 years is something that was important to me, and to make sure that Rodney and Greg and Tony all had somebody, you know, that they were comfortable with fitting into the group, because it's a special group of people, and with the, you know, the background that Josh has and the background that Rodney has, and just there's a lot of common denominators that really just made sense. And so, you know, really from the, I think I asked the question, gosh, it was probably about a year ago, you know, if Josh was on that list. And I asked, you know, probably, I don't remember exact time frame, but earlier this year, and you know, here it is today, because I've talked to Rodney about it a lot. And, you know, in those conversations, you know, Josh was always the name that he just never wavered on. So you know, for me, it was fun to watch it progress. And, you know, this year has kind of been interesting because I've kind of tried to stand back and let these guys do more and work towards the future. And to see it all come together makes me happy to know that everything is going to be in good hands.
And now Greg Zipadelli, Chief Competition Officer for Stewart-Haas Racing. Greg, we've been blessed with Kevin's veteran leadership, poise, maturity, and even though Josh is going to be a rookie next year, we still get veteran leadership, poise, maturity. How important is that to the overall success of the organization?
Oh, it's huge. I mean, Kevin is living, you know, he's leaving really big shoes to fill, no pressure, Josh. But honestly, Kevin's leadership over the last 10 years, his direction, you know, has been instrumental to Stewart-Haas. And I think we all thought that Josh has some of them same attributes within him. You look at his racing in the past and where he's come, and he's always made himself successful in the right ways, racing hard, clean, like I said earlier, a lot of grit. I think he's going to fit in with our group well, just from, you know, I hate to keep saying it, but we're all still a bunch of racers, and I think he fits right into our group that way. And I think, like Kevin mentioned, some of those things, how important it is that he fits in, his, you know, his just philosophy in racing, I think fits in, and hopefully that makes, you know, the learning curve of and the pressure that he'll have next year of being full-time in Cup, I think it'll make a lot of that easier for him.
And finally, Rodney Childers, crew chief for the number four team at Stewart-Haas Racing. Rodney, you built the number four team from scratch, and all the accolades that Kevin has enjoyed, you've been a part of that too and enjoyed them as well. Now you're in the position of building it for the future. It's a great challenge, a great opportunity as well. How much are you relishing your current time with Kevin while also thinking about how you come out of the gate strong in 2024?
Yeah, I mean, you know, 10 years has flown by in a hurry, but, you know, to have the relationship that I've had with Kevin the last 10 years and to do the things that we've done, and, you know, you look back on some of those, you know, special moments of, you know, winning a championship and winning races and, you know, going on streaks of, you know, finishing the top five, you know, 10 races in a row, or, you know, top twos for eight races in a row and stuff like that. That's just something that's really unheard of. And, you know, our whole group has been, you know, part of that, and just a special group from top to bottom. You know, our shop guys, our pit crew, our road guys, and just everybody involved. So, you know, that part is extremely, you know, special to me. And then it just goes to Josh. You know, I think everybody knows I'm a Josh Berry fan, and that's really what, you know, I think some of this came down to. Is I told the shop guys at Stewart-Haas this morning, I wish Dale could go back through his phone and you know, count how many times that I text him saying that if that guy could ever get the right opportunity, he's going to, you know, show something. And it's just cool as crap today to see him up here with us and to be able to go racing with him and to, you know, have that same common goal. And also, I think, you know, everybody knows what your relationships mean to me. And like Kevin said, having somebody that could fit into that, somebody that I can text 100 times a day like I do this guy beside me and he doesn't care. And, you know, I think having that relationship and, you know, the common backgrounds and common goals is really important.
All right, we'll go ahead and open it up to questions. Just raise your hand. Jamie's got a mic, and we'll start right over here with Steve Post of MRN.
Steve Post, Motor Racing Network. Tony, I want to play off something Greg said, and actually Rodney alluded to, racer. You've been around. You've been one. Can you kind of define that and how Josh fits into that grassroots, that short track, that mindset that he brings and that appeal that he brings to you?
Hey, don't forget, I'm still a racer, bud. I'm not long gone yet, all right? But no, you're right. It's, you know, and that's something that's a really big part of our DNA at Stewart-Haas Racing. It's not about guys that just come in, spend their time during the day, and when the clock gets to the point where it's time to leave, they all just bail out of there. We've got people there that care about race cars, and that's all they think about is racing. I mean, that's what this guy has done for years. He lives, eats, breathes racing, and that's all he wants to do, so aside from his family. So, but that's what we want. That's the DNA we want. That's what, you know, our culture at SHR is built around, is a bunch of people that just want to go win races and contend for championships. So that's why, that's one of the many reasons why he's such a good fit for our organization right now.
Jordan.
Jordan Bianchi. Jordan Bianchi, The Athletic. This kind of, you guys have kind of touched on this, and this is a question for all of you. Josh isn't bringing sponsorship. He's kind of one of those blue-collar guys that just kind of earned this on merit. Can you talk about that and why he kind of represents kind of a throwback in some respects? And then, Josh, what does this mean for you to kind of earn this on merit and not have to bring sponsorship with you?
I'll start. I don't mind this one. I'm not interested in some kid's father coming and buying their way into the Cup Series. I have zero interest in that. We want guys that earn their way, that work hard, that understand the values that it takes to be a top-tier driver, not one that just got his high school diploma and now all of a sudden he's a Cup driver. I've got zero interest in that. Josh has put the time, the effort, and every time he's got an opportunity, he's made the most of it. And that's the traits that championship drivers are built off of, not the easy ticket to get there. I mean, this guy has had to sit there every time he's made a change. He's had to make the most of it. So, you know, that's why.
Bob?
Yeah, no, to answer your question, yeah, I mean, it definitely, you know, it means a lot. The journey that it took to get here, right, was, you know, it was an amazing journey to get here, racing late model stocks and Xfinity cars, obviously, for Junior Motorsports. And the success we have is something that I will forever look back on so fondly, and I enjoyed so much of that moment getting here. But the reality of it is heading to the Cup Series, you know, that nobody really cares what your path was to get there. And, you know, I'm ready for that challenge. I'm ready for the opportunity that's ahead of me to try to make a name for myself in the Cup Series. So really, you know, I'm proud of how I got here, but, you know, the work for 2024 starts today and has started before today as well.
Bob Hockers, Fox Sports. Kind of along that line, Tony, do you have sponsors that are kind of are set to come to the fore, or are you totally open for next year?
Right at this point, totally open. So we're having discussions internally with current sponsors, and then we have a lot of potential sponsors that are interested in this program as well. So nothing to announce on that side yet, but a lot of conversations going on right now.
Yep, go ahead.
Trey Downey, Motor Racing Network. This is for Tony. How much did what Josh did filling in the 9 and the 48 earlier this year lend to this decision, and did that fill-in duty at all delay this announcement?
We had made the decision before he was filling in, but you know, it was great for us. We're sitting there in the back smiling, and you know, he's getting free track time on somebody else's dollar. but it was good experience, and it really gave us a good opportunity to, you know, anytime you move somebody up in a division, you don't know till you see them in the car what they're going to do, and it's obviously a risk, but we had made the decision internally what our play was and what we wanted to do. What was the second part of it? I'm sorry.
Did the fill-in duty at all delay this announcement?
It actually did a little bit, and it was just out of respect for Rick Hendrick and Hendrick Motorsports and their partners and OEMs, of making sure that we weren't doing something that was going to disrupt the opportunity that Josh had to get laps and to do a good job without the headaches and hassles and it being complicated. So we tried to work together to make it as easy for him as possible.
Zach Sterniolo, NASCAR.com. Josh, for you, I'm curious just the significance of taking over this car particularly and with this team, obviously championship caliber, but having the belief of everyone on the stage with you there and them so vocal about it, what has that part of this process meant to you along the way?
Yeah, no, it's... you know, it really means a lot to have the support that I've had. And obviously to get to this point, you know, I knew that everybody at SHR and this group beside me, you know, believes in me and what I bring to the table. So it's going to be, it's like I said, it's going to be a great challenge, you know, trying to fill the job that Kevin's done over the years. I mean, he's a future Hall of Famer and has won countless races and championship, and still has a, I don't know, I've been watching the races this year, and these guys have been running really well from what I've been seeing. So it's really encouraging for me and exciting for me to know that, you know, I'm going to get such a great group around me. And, you know, I tend to do everything I can to try to keep that group together and excited to work with me. And I know that, you know, I'll have, you know, I'll have some great support with Tony and Kevin and Dale as well as I transition to a full-time Cup driver. So it's all great. You know, it's like I said, I really can't imagine myself going into a better opportunity.
Well, we wait on some other questions. You know, Josh's background in late model racing is extremely stout. Rodney, can you kind of, I guess, elaborate on it? You were a successful late model racer before you were a successful crew chief. And you saw Josh Berry in his early days, and you knew immediately the talent that he had. Can you just talk about that platform and what he's done there to allow him this opportunity?
Yeah, on the late model side of it, you could see it from the very beginning. You know, the very early days of going to Hickory and running on Saturday night to, you know, a year or two later of just completely dominating every time you went. And then watching, you know, the Cars Tour races and other things. But it also goes along to, you know, doing things like he did at the Snowball Derby last year of going down there and, you know, maybe some people expecting him not to do a whole lot and sits on the front row and runs up front all day. So, you know, you could just always see it from the very beginning. And, you know, to me, you know, as y'all know, I went through that same stuff and, you know, like you were talking about making it on merit. You know, he's kind of went about it the same way that I was trying to go about it. So I've just always had just a ton of respect for that. And, you know, we've both had great opportunities to get to where we're at, obviously, and to be able to work together and to, you know, share some of that on the weekends of watching late model races and talking about that kind of stuff is, you know, kind of an icebreaker in a way and makes it fun. And, you know, hopefully we can run some late model races together too. That'd be a lot of fun.
Yep. Pat Jaggers, Motor Racing Network. This question's for Josh. When you think about people that have supported you over the years, someone you mentioned earlier was Dale Earnhardt Jr. He's been very instrumental in your racing career when it comes to the NASCAR level. What conversations did you have with him throughout the process? And when did you tell him that you were going to take this opportunity? And what was that conversation like?
Well, you know, obviously they've, you know, Dale and LW and Kelly have been there every step of the way throughout this process. You know, they're fully aware of the, you know, opportunity that I had potentially in front of me. And we're in full support. So, you know, to answer your question, they've been, you know, supportive of me the whole way. And, you know, kind of like Tony said, you know, this actually began before the season started. And so the opportunity and the timing that was presented with the 9 and then the 48 is just kind of crazy to even really think about. And Dale was super helpful to me as I navigated through that, because, you know, not only am I trying to race for a championship and compete for wins in the Xfinity Series, you know, I'm filling in for Chase and then Alex unexpectedly in a last second scenario, especially the first week. And then in the process of, you know, figuring out and negotiating my future. So it was a lot. And Dale was a great asset to me through that, more, not only as a boss, but just as a friend. And so I'm definitely grateful for that. And I'm grateful for everything they've done for me over the years, right? We had an emotional meeting this morning at Junior Motorsports with the whole company as we, you know, let them know this news. And, you know, it just was just a special day for all of us that, you know, had a part in getting me here.
Seth Ecker, KickingTires.net. This is for Josh. From when you won in the Xfinity Series in 2021 at Martinsville to now, could you have envisioned getting this opportunity as quickly as you were able to?
No. You know, lots happened really quickly, right? Especially in the last 3 years. I think, really almost 3 years to the day, I'm in the midst of beginning, you know, making a run to try to win the weekly series national championship in our late model stock in the early weeks of that run. So in 3 years, I've went, you know, from racing a late model at Hickory to, you know, in the, you know, accepting and starting a journey in the Cup Series with Stewart-Haas Racing. So it's been a journey without a doubt. And, you know, I'm just thankful. We, you know, there's been so many moments over the last couple years, you know, but the win at Martinsville was really, I think, what changed my future. It opened up opportunities that, you know, we were able to secure some funding and partnerships to go full-time Xfinity racing, and also was able to, you know, get some opportunities and other cars and trucks and whatnot along the way. And, you know, that was just really the snowball that really got everything going. So it's just it's been a lot of fun over the last couple of years for sure. It's been a whirlwind.
Deb Williams, Auto Week. This is for Tony. Tony, the statement that you just made a few minutes ago about you're not interested in a young driver whose dad buys him a ride, that has given a lot of hope, I'm sure, to young drivers when they hear this who don't have any money. So what advice would you give to them when they look at Josh, I'm sure, as an example, but what advice would you give to them to make it to where they want to be if they don't have the funding?
I'd say the first thing is don't get discouraged if your parents aren't wealthy and can buy your way to the top. You know, I think for young people, the biggest thing that I try to emphasize is have fun doing what you're doing, no matter what level of motorsports you're at. Have fun. A, you got to have fun doing it. But B, it's just work hard. I mean, it's Josh's proof, Kevin's proof, I'm proof, Rodney's proof, Zippy's proof, everybody up here is proof that if you work hard, you can get where you want to be, but you got to put the work in and the time and the effort that it takes to do that. And I really don't think people in general realize the sacrifices that people at this level have to make to get here. There's things that you sacrifice and you either put on hold or you don't get to do in your life because you're so dedicated to motorsports. And I think that's what makes these top tier people top tier. The time and dedication that it takes. And so that's the advice that I give to kids and their parents. It's, you know, we're in this era where we're seeing kids at 12, 14 years old driving late models, which I think is ludicrous. I don't think there's any reason for it. There's nothing they're going to miss by waiting until they're 16 or 18 to get in full-size race cars. And their bodies aren't mature. Their minds aren't mature. You know, I don't understand the rush. I want somebody that's had to go through hard times, somebody that knows what it takes to go up and down the road, that mentally is stable and understands what it takes to compete at this level and you know, knows how to sit there and not just go fast in the car, but how to put the race together and how to, you know when it's time to push, when it's not time to push. That's what has made Kevin so successful over all these years is he is, in my opinion, the smartest driver in the series right now. He has been for many years. He just knows how to put the whole race together. If it's not right, he gets to the end of the stint, gives Rodney a chance to make adjustments, and when it's time to push and when he can push, he does. But, you know, it's you just don't see drivers that have that kind of savvy anymore, and, you know, Josh is one of those guys that we do see that in. I mean, we know that he knows how to plan for the entire race, not just for the lap he's on.
Lewis.
Yeah, Lewis Frank Reuters. Rodney, how soon can you first start to work with Josh? And aside from seat fitting, what are the first steps?
Yeah, I don't think I even know the answer to that yet. I think the relationship building is the most important part. And I think that's what helped, you know, Kevin and myself the most going into 2014. We had a year of that relationship building, it seemed like. And, you know, I already think that, you know, the relationship that I have with Josh is probably ahead of where I was when I first met Kevin, just, you know, just because of talking about late models for the last 5 years. So, you know, I think that's the biggest thing. You know, we both have huge tasks on our hands, you know, the rest of the year. You know, we need to win races in the four car, and we need to make a run at the championship, and that's our goal. And he needs to do the same thing on the Xfinity side. So, you know, we're going to keep it simple. You know, I know from my standpoint, it's going to be staying in touch once a week and building on that relationship. But other than that, it's going to be focusing on our jobs that we have and trying to win races.
Cool. We'll go Bob, then Jordan, and then Lee.
Bob Pockers, Fox Sports. For Kevin, I'm going to assume that you agree with Tony on Josh being kind of mentally ready in the way he is able to handle races. But I'm curious how you know that when he only has 10 cup starts.
Well, I think that the best evidence of that is exactly what he did in the 9 and the 48, right? I mean, jumping in those cars, seats don't fit, don't know the people very well, and going in and being competitive and figuring it out. And I think that's one of the more unique scenarios about Josh is he's a little bit older, has a family, and you don't have to teach him about life, right? You know, there's a maturity factor that goes with life, and I think he's lived through, you know, some of the most important parts and had his face dragged through the mud and all the things that it takes in order to figure out that it's not easy and you have to work hard and you have to have your ducks in a row and be able to have that circle of life well put together around you in order to be successful at this. Because if there's any piece of the circle that's, you know, being disrupted at that particular moment, it's going to disrupt everything. And you can say that it doesn't, but it does. And, you know, I think his maturity, you see what he does on the racetrack, but I think a lot of this success in this particular division depends on what's happening outside of the race car. And I think, you know, having, you know, experience to lean on, I know he leans on Dale a lot, and Dale is, you know, is a great mentor to have because of everything that he has done at such a high level, and to have that ability to pick up the phone. Well, I think a lot of times you probably don't pick up the phone, do you? It probably rings. he's telling you that, yeah, he's telling you that that you messed something up, and I think that's great, you know, having people that can give you an honest opinion and tell you what they think, and you know that they're telling you to be able to try and help you, and having those assets and being willing to take those opinions and apply them is important. So there's a number of things outside of the car that he demonstrates well, you know, when it comes to life in general. And, you know, this is not, you can have fun doing this, but it's way more fun if you win. So, you know, in order to do that, you have to have everything else together.
Next we'll go here to Lee, and then we'll get a mic to you, Jordan.
Lee Spencer, catchfence.com. Just curious, Kevin, are you going to be staying around in a consulting role or anything next year?
We have a lot of things happening currently. You know, I'm here to help. These guys I'll always be here to help. You know, from his standpoint and these two guys. But you know, right now from the management side, we've got some other business things happening. Cars tour, Keelan, and everything that we have going on. I don't have any plans from the team side of things.
Jordan
Bianchi, Athletic. This question's for Greg. Was Ford involved in this process at all, recruiting a Chevy driver over to your team?
No, this was a SHR courting, and just because of who we believe in, as everybody's mentioned up here. You know, simply what Josh has accomplished and what we think he has to bring. So, no, there was none of that.
No, I mean, I asked this because I didn't know if they were enticed by the prospect of, you know, stealing somebody basically from a rival team, and they were kind of encouraged by this, they supported this, that kind of thing.
No, I mean, we internally have made a decision and direction we were going, and then shared it with them, and obviously they were excited and feel like he's a great talent for the future, but no, there wasn't any strategic moves there.
Any other questions? Anyone in the back? All right, before we send these guys to their one-on-one interview stations, we are going to do a group photo with all of them right here up front, and then once we get that, we'll have Kevin here, I think Josh in the middle, Tony in the end, and then Rodney and Zippy will be on either side of the dais here. So, again, thank you very much for your time. We certainly appreciate it. Have a great day.